Okay, so welcome to session 5. My name is Yu Sasaki from NTT. So this session is a Stream Cipher 1, especially for RC4 Stream Cipher. The session consists of two talks. Let's start the first talk. The title is Smashing Web in a Passive Attack. The authors are Owen Sefredat, Pedro Susio, Serge Bodoni, and Martin Burnham. Oh yeah, I'll give the talk.
Thank you very much. So I'm very happy to present this work today because this is the result of very hard work of us during the last 2 years. So we did lots of analysis, theoretical analysis in Europe in 2011, so you might have already heard about those. So we computed a theoretical framework analysis of web and WPA attacks by optimizing all the existing attacks. We found out many new ones. We changed the attacks, optimized them, and so on. And at that time, we didn't implement the attacks. So currently, the main contributions of this paper would be providing a patch on AirCrackNG, which is a software that is used for cracking web and WPA in real life that behaves much, much, much faster and better than AirCrack. So I'm going to describe it now. This is a joint work with Per Socius and Martin Wood. Okay, so if you probably go to Europe, everyone will tell you whoever uses web these days. So web is not used anymore, why are you trying to analyze it anymore? So if you look around you, at least in Singapore, if you look at hotels, restaurants, or even airports, you will see that almost like 20% of the wireless networks around you is web, or even more of them. So, and this is not a problem of Singapore alone, it's almost the same in most Asia and Middle East, if you don't consider Middle East Asia. So, this is already web should be deprecated already, but it's still widely used in several countries, so this is already motivated that our work is still useful, and you can still have attacks on web which are behaving extremely fast. For instance, I was really surprised to see that even in Changi Airport, we're still using web, and it's not even 128-bit version, it's a 40-bit version that you don't need any attack, you can just brute force it. So, let's go to the outline of my talk. So first, I will give you a reminder on RC4 Stream Cipher, how it can be adapted to be used in web application. Then I will mention an optimized attack we have on web, which we call them Tornado attack. I will explain why we call it Tornado. And finally, the challenges that we face to adapt our theory into practice. Okay, RC4. So RC4 consists of two distinct algorithms. The first one is called key scheduling algorithm. The second one is called PRGA. So you give an initial key as an input. And then the role of the KSA is to scramble the state of the RC4. At the end, you will get some state. We call them Sn-1, or n is here 256. So we get a state that is called S255, which why we call it S255? Because we update the state 256 times. So initially it's S-1, after 256 update, it's called S255. So you give this scrambled state into PRGA algorithm, and then it gives you a new key stream. Each key stream is a byte, so anytime that you need a new byte, you run this PRGA once. So, let's tell you exactly how it works. So you have a 256 byte, which is identity permutation. So you have 0, 1, up to 256. And then you have two registers called I and J. So the value of I, if you look at here, it's incremented each time. So it's for every state update, I is completely predictable. But the value of J depends on the value of the key. So it's pseudo-random. So in every state update, you swap the value of S of I and S of J. So 7 comes here, 0 comes here. And then you increment, in the next state update, you increment the I by 1. And then J, for instance, depending on the value of the key, it goes to index 12. Then you swap the value of these two values, so 12 comes here, 1 comes here, and then you repeat this process 256 times. At the end, what you will get is a scrambled state that looks like this. So then the difference between the PRGA and KSA is that in PRGA, this time I starts from 1 and J depends on some value of the state. You again do the swapping, so 3 and 7 are swapped, and then to compute the key stream, we compute this function, S of I plus S of J, which in this case, it's S of I is 7, S of j is 3, so it's S of 10, and S of 10 is 189. So you output 189. Anytime that you need a new key string, you run this PRJ once more, it generates you a new one. So that's simply how RC4 works. So RC4 can be used in different applications. For instance, one of the applications is web, it's using WPA, it's using SSL TLS, and several other applications. So the next slide, you'll probably hear about it in broadcast encryption mode. So how is it used in web? So the main difference between RC4 and web, using of RC4 in web, is that first of all, we are attacking web in the version of 128-bit key. So our key is divided into 16 bytes, so you have K0 to K15, and the key stream is called Z1 to as many bytes as one. So what happens is that if you replace RC4 with web, since there is no IB embedded into RC4, the designer of web has to have some IB embedded into RC4. So what they decided to do is to give the first 3 bytes of the key to the attacker. So these values are IB0, IB1, and IB2 given in clear text over the channel. And the mistake they made, or maybe they didn't know that was a mistake because they assumed that RC4 is perfectly secure, is that these 13 bytes left are completely fixed for the next packet encryptions. So these values are not changing for the next consequent packets. So that's because of some biases and correlations you have in RC4, this made the web vulnerable. And you can run a statistical attack on the 13 bytes and find the key pretty straightforward. Okay, so let's talk about the attack and how it works. So as any other stream software, you input the key, you output the key stream. So what are the correlations we are trying to find out here? So imagine that we have access to the key stream and our goal is to revert this process and find out the key. So you might ask, okay, yes, in theory, in crypto we assume we have the key stream, but what happens in practice? Why do we have the key stream? We have only the ciphertext. So due to the protocol specification of IEEE 802.11 in both web and WPA, some of the initial bytes of the key stream correspond to known headers in ARP and TCP IP packets, so they're already known. So you know, for instance, up to the 32nd byte of the key stream, these are known, so you just XOR the ciphertext to get the key stream. So the main goal is to revert this process and have some correlations that have some predictions or vote for the value of the key. So how does these biases look like? So we call them conditional biases. There are pairs of a function called fj and a probability called pj and a predicate. So what we do, we get the key stream, we just drop it from the communication channel, and then we check whether this predicate holds. We have z and some clue that we can assume it's known. If this predicate holds, then you say that the value of k bar I is equal to a specific function, depends on the value of the key stream. And this relation holds with some probability. So why do I say k bar I? What's the difference between k bar I and ki? K bar is a summation of the bytes of the key from 0 to I. So you have k0 plus k1 up to ki, which is 1 over z256. So this is because of some technical reasons, because it increases our success probability. So you can look at the paper to find out exactly why. So this is one of the biases, for instance, that we have in reality. So this is a famous bias called AU15, and these are the predicates. So you look at the value of Z2 in reality, if it's 0, and if the value of ST of I is 0, so T is an index that is known, this means the state after the T's iteration of the KSA at index I, if it is 0, then you vote for the value of the key. So you say that the value of K bar I is equal to 2 minus sigma I with some probability. And sigma I is assumed as a value that we know. We can compute it. So in RC4, in web applications, we have 22 of such biases. And each of them have different probabilities, different conditions, different key recovery relations, and so on. So what we did in EuroCrypt is that we computed a framework how to analyze these all biases with different conditions and so on in an optimized manner, so we can get the most we can get out of all those biases to drop the number of packets we need to break them. Okay, so I'm going to tell you the trend of the attacks starting web. So in 1994, RC4 was disclosed anonymously, and then the first attacks from 1995 by Roos correlation, and then the famous attack of Lohmann, Dan, and Shamir in 2001 who broke web. And then you have Korek attack, which appeared in 2004, and software such as AirCrack and G, which could break wireless communication, appeared in 2004. And then you have this PTW attack, the famous attack called breaking web in less than 60 seconds. And then you have up to now, which is 2013. What I want to focus in this picture is this. So by the initial attack of Laurent Montana and Shamir, you needed 5,500,000 packets to break web. This was dropped to 100,000 by having the correct attacks. And finally, right now what we have is that we almost need something like 20,000 packets to break web. And we think that maybe beating this is would be extremely hard. So coming up with something less than this, the current biases that exist for us before is hard, but if you find more correlations, you can probably drop this number of packets. And this 19,800, where is it coming from? It's if we only restrict the running time of the attack to only 5 seconds on a normal PC. So if you want to run it for, I don't know, 1 hour, this 19,800 will be dropped much less. This is only restricted if the attack only runs for only 5 seconds, around 5 seconds on a PC. Okay, so how does the attack work? So I will just briefly tell you how it works, I'm not going to go to the detail. So due to some reasons, due to some relation that exists on RC4, it's always good to recover the value of k-bar 15 first. Because we can merge some of our correlations we have on RC4 if we have the value of k-bar 15. So that, therefore you have a loop here that computes the value of k-bar 15. How is this computation done? We look at all the biases we have for RC4 that votes for the value of k-bar 15. We look at the key stream, if the predicate is hold, we increment the counter corresponding to the index that we're interested in the table of k-bar 15, which is index is 0 to 255, the corresponding value. And then at the end, we sort the value and we pick the best value. So this will be the best value for, best vote for the k-bar 15. Using this value of k-bar 15, then we vote for the value of k-bar 3 similarly. Then we update the state to S3, because we have the value of k-bar 3, so we can update the state to S3. And then we recover k-bar 4. Then we update the state to S4, and we do this recursively, as you see in this loop, till we recover k-bar 14. And at the end, you have the value of k-bar 3 to k-bar 15, and the value of k0, k1, and k2 are IDs already known. You check if the key is correct. If it's correct, you're happy. If it's not correct, you do the recursive attack again and again till you succeed. For instance, one of the differences that we saw between practice and theory is that here you have a recursive loop. So having a recursive loop in reality when you're implementing an attack is extremely expensive. Because if you make a wrong assumption in any of these steps, everything afterwards in theory would be completely wrong. So in our experiment, what we saw was that even if you have, for instance, a wrong guess for the value of k-bar 3, we can still recover, in many, many cases, with high probability, the value of k-bar 4. And this is because if the value of k-bar 3 is guessed incorrectly, it only changes, it only modifies 16 consequent swaps out of 256 swaps possible. So it doesn't have that much effect if you guess k-bar 3 incorrectly. So at the end, in practice, we decided not to do this recursively, and we did it in a non-recursive manner, and we obtained almost the same results, which obtained much faster in reality compared to if you want to do it in a recursive manner. So what's important that I want to focus here, because I'm going to talk about it later, is we have a value that we call it y of x. It's a counter for x. What's the meaning of a counter for x? So as I said, you have a table with indexes 0, 1 to 255, and you are voting for those values. So the value for each of these, anytime that you increase the counter corresponding to value, we call that specific index counter. So you have the counter, we call it y of x. And what's the meaning of rank of x? So after you sort the specific table, then imagine that the best element in the list, we assume that its rank is 0. The second best element, the index, the rank is 1, and so on, the worst one is 255. So r of x just means rank of x. So all the parameters you see in this attack are completely optimized, and we check in practice, and they really work. So what are the challenges we face when we try to implement the attack compared to what we did in York? Okay, so in our paper in Eurogrip, we made a heuristic assumption that the variance of the good counter is not equal to the variance of the bad counter. Y of good and y of bad. Y of good means the counter corresponding to the correct value of the key, and the bad counters are all the other counters we have. When we implemented the attack, found out that the result doesn't match what we predict, we started testing what's going on, and we found out by implementing that those variances don't match. So this can be easily solved. We just change the formula, it's easily solved. The second part was we also make a heuristic assumption that the random variables y good minus y i's for all bad i's are independent. That's something you always do in theory to simplify your analysis. Then we tested in practice, they were independent. So this can be again solved. We just had some bunch of integrals. It can be solved again. But then the problem came here. We assumed that the rank of the correct counter is normally distributed. Then in reality, it wasn't normally distributed. Then we assume, okay, so it should be Poisson distribution. But then the expected value and the variance weren't the same. So another question was that what's the distributions of this specific rank? So the only way that remained for us is to compute the distribution in reality in packets that we use from and see how does the distribution look like. So this is how the distribution look like. So here you have the rank from 0 to 15. So R3 meaning that it's the rank of the correct counter for recovering the value of K bar 3. So if you have rank 0, it means your correct key is the best element in the list. And if the rank is, for instance, 50, it means that your correct value, the key, is the 50th element in the list. So of course, the 0, 1 has the highest probability and so on. So this might look like an exponential distribution, but it's not. So then we started matching all the distributions that are out there with these three and see how, which of them looks like this distribution. That's the only option we found. So then we found out that there's a distribution called Fourier distribution, which is a generalization of negative binomial distribution, which I draw it in MATLAB, and it exactly matches what you see in practice. So there's a red curve and a blue curve. One of these is the practical experiments, and the other one is the exact definition of the probability distribution. So you see they're exactly on each other. Now when you have two distributions that are on top of each other, exactly, there should be a justification for that. So we started looking at where is the use of Fourier distribution and use of negative binomial distributions. And we found out that the main application is in analysis of frequency of hail occurrences and in tornado analysis. So that's where the name tornado attacks is coming from. So we started reading some papers about tornadoes and hails. And these papers are from 60s. Some of them are typed by a typewriter and so on. So for instance, here you can see, it says hail occurrence being a comparatively rare event is fit well by the Poisson distribution, providing the hail storms are independent. When this condition is not met, hail occurrence follows a negative binomial distribution. Or there's another paper called tornado probabilities you have here, 1963. This is another sentence from that paper. So if I want to summarize what is the contributions of those two papers, they say that, okay, tornadoes and hails are something that are rare. So we assume in reality we model them with a Poisson distribution. But in some areas that you have a high frequency of tornadoes or hails, then if one hail or tornado happens, it affects the probability that the second one happens. So you have multiple Poisson distributions that are dependent. So the contributions of those papers was to say that if you have multiple Poisson distributions that were dependent, the joint distribution of all of them would be following negative binomial distribution. So then we started looking, do we have the same situation here? And we had exactly similar situation. So what's the meaning of the probability that our rank is zero? So this means that the value of the good counter is more than the first bad counter, is more than the second bad counter, up to the more than the 255th bad counter. So you have a random variable y of good minus y of bad, which is following Poisson distribution, and so on. So you have some Poisson distribution, 256 Poisson distribution, that, as I said, we tested in practice, they were dependent. So the joint distribution of all of them would be following the Poisson distribution. So that was a good justification to make sure why our distribution is following polio. So solving this problem and also the other two problems, then we had something that completely works in practice. So one more thing that I want to focus on between the challenges we have with comparing theory to practice. So these are the structure of the R packets in the wireless company in the 802.11 and also in TCP/IP packets that you send over the channel. So when we are talking about R packets, we are talking about an active attack on web because you are doing ARP injection into the network. So the problem of active attacks is that some of the drivers that you have out there for your network cards are not able to inject packets into traffic. So you need some extra patches for the driver to make it able to inject data to the traffic. So for some network cards out there, if you go to the first web page of AirPack, they have many several pages how to make your network card be able to inject packets. For some network cards, there is no one available. So there is always a hope that we can drop the number of packets for a passive attack. So we don't need to do any type of injection into the system. We just drop the packets, and then we still have a successful attack. Then this is this would be the TCP/IP packet. So you just listen to the communication, and then you drop the packets and you succeed. But then the problem of the passive attacks using only TCP/IP packets is these values that you see here. So the values that are completely gray, dark gray, are the values you cannot guess them. These are the values that are not unknown. It means that, for instance, you cannot recover the key string corresponding to these two bytes, and also these two bytes and these two bytes. And the ones that are in light gray are the ones that you need to guess them. You might guess them correctly or might not guess them. But these values cannot be recovered. And the ones that are on white, you can recover them very easily. They are known. So these are the values of them here. So you see that comparing TCP/IP packets with R packets, there are many values that are unknown while you already know them in R packets. That's why that the active attacks on web works much better than the passive attacks, because you cannot recover the specific bytes. So these are something that we have to consider in the theory and so on to be able to apply to practice. So this is the result that we have. So we are going to put this patch online in a week. We're writing some manuals about it to just put it online. So I'm going to put it on the LastSec web page on EPFL, so we can have it published. It will be publicly available. You can download it. So this is a comparison with the current aircrack NG that is out there on R-Attack. So here is aircrack NG in active attack mode, which you need to inject packets into the traffic. This is our passive attack mode. So you see that this attack outperforms much better than the aircrack in active attack mode. So we have a passive attack that behaves much faster than aircrack in active attack mode. And this is the attack that is active, or attack that in active attack mode. So for instance, to have success probability of 50%, you need something like 22,500 packets to break web. But with 22,500 packets, you have only something like 3% of success rate if you use the current version of aircrack and disruptor. Okay. So do I have some 2 minutes or something?
Yes.
Yes? Oh, okay. So I have 3 minutes left. So I'm going to just... So the problem here is that in active attacks, you are using R packets. And in passive attack, you are using TCP/IP packets. So here in R packets, we can recover all of the key string bytes. For instance, in these bytes, you can recover this value, you can recover this value, you can recover this value. This is not possible for TCP/IP packets, because these headers are not guessable. And these TCP/IP packets and R packets are encrypted, so you cannot guess those specific values. That's why that the passive attacks behave much slower than the active attacks.
Okay, so let's thank the speaker again.